Hey friends, it's 10 p.m. and this is the fourth video I've recorded. So you're not getting me at my best. I'm sorry. You deserve better. But let's see what we can get done here. We are doing the section today referred to as trigonometric integrals. This is not trig substitutions. This is the prelude to trig substitutions. Okay. Trigonometric integrals. The base notion is that you have to remember your two, no, three Pythagorean identities. Cosine squared plus sine squared equals one. That's one of them. But then one plus tangent squared is secant squared. And one plus cotangent squared is cosecant squared. Okay. So try to keep those in mind. I've got them illustrated here. But it'll take a second to bring it up, as usual. Zoom. Okay. Takes a minute. There we go. All right. Now we're cooking with gas. So, as mentioned, the things that we're gonna hit a lot of are right here. So cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to one. And then where's the other one? And then the tan squared plus one equals secant squared. If you choose your u to be sine theta, your du then has to be cosine theta d theta. However, I'm going to urge you to think about that in reverse. Look for what it makes sense to make your du be, and that will guide what your u will be. All right. Then, when we talk about tangents and secants, if you let your u be tangent, your du is secant squared. But again, look to see whether secant squared makes sense for a du, and that will make your u's work. And on the other hand, if secant tangent makes sense for a du, then your u will be secant, right? We'll get guidance on those as we go along here. Because I had to wait an interminable amount of time to get videos uploaded, I sat here and color coded and stuff like that. So all the ones that are sine and cosine ones, I have color coded in pink. Ignore that. If that, yeah, try to ignore that and try to figure them out yourself. But on this one here, we have a cosine squared and times a sine. The key thing is there's one power of sine. That means that that would be a good thing to put in your du. So I'm going to come along here and say that my du, I want to be the sine x dx. And that means my u is the cosine x, not the cosine squared, just the cosine x. And once you know that, then that integral turns into an integral of u squared du. Okay. And that then is one third u cubed plus c. And that is one third cosine cubed x plus c. And you're done. Okay. So anytime you have a single power of sine or cosine, choose that to be your du. And then your u will have to be the other. Okay. Yay. All right. And so Except, notice I got the wrong answer. As I said, I'm not at my best. I needed that to have a minus, and it doesn't, right? So the way to fix that is to make this be minus cosine. And that means when we substitute back in here, we end up getting a minus 1 cubed. So that gives us the minus 1/3 cosine cubed x plus c. Okay. All right. Sorry about that. Then this next one here, again, I would advise you to try to get it figured out. But we have an odd power of cosines and an even power of sines. So that means we can pull off a cosine theta d theta to be our du, and the corresponding u has to be sine theta. Now, the thing is that when we rewrite this a little bit and pull our cosine on at the end, then we've got a cosine squared theta, sine squared theta, cosine theta d theta, right? So that means that we've got the cosine theta here at the end. The rest of it needs to be just sines, and it's not. However, cosine squared is really 1 minus sine squared. So I'm going to rewrite this as integral 1 minus sine squared theta. Sine squared theta, what's the last? Cosine theta d theta, right? And that is really the integral quantity 1 minus u squared du, which is the integral of u squared minus u to the fourth du, which is 1/3 u cubed minus 1/4, no, 1/5 u to the fifth. Let's see. So we have 1/3 u with sine theta, so 1/3 sine cubed theta minus 1/5 sine to the fifth theta plus c. That is perfectly fine to leave it as, but if you notice it's got a sine cubed, you could factor that out and maybe it simplifies a little bit or something. I don't know. I think that's good enough though, right? Okay, let's try another one. So this one has even powers of sine and cosine, so you can't just pull one off. So when I turn this over to people, what they usually immediately try to make work is they try to get rid of one or the other. So they'll turn cosine squared into 1 minus sine squared. So then they have 1 minus sine squared times sine squared. They still don't have an odd power. So the key on this is to use this identity that, how's it go? Cosine squared theta turns out to be 1 plus sine 2 theta. Is it sine 2 theta? No, it's cosine 2 theta. Sorry. Cosine 2 theta over 2. And sine squared theta turns out to be 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2. Okay. Those are referred to as the power reduction identities. And the thing that's going on with them is that when you have formulas for cosine 2 theta, there were two different versions of it. Actually, there were three different versions of it, but one of them had cosine squareds and no sine squareds. One of them had sine squareds and no cosine squareds. So in order to make use of that, we're going to come along here and do the integral. Cosine squared becomes 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2. Sine squared becomes 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 2. And we still have a d theta at the end. That is 1/4 of the integral. When you multiply those together, you end up with 1 minus cosine squared of 2 theta d theta, which is equal to 1/4 the integral of sine squared 2 theta d theta. Okay. Which is still even powers. So you can use it again and turn this into 1/4 the integral 1 minus cosine. Now, before it was 2 theta, but now you have to multiply 2 times 2 theta. Think of it as doubling the angle. So that means 4 theta over 2 d theta, which means we have 1/8 of the integral quantity 1 minus cosine 4 theta d theta, but that is 1/8 of theta minus 1/4 of sine 4 theta. But when you integrate cosine, you pick up a negative. So I'm going to put this over there, close that, and then I'm going to put my plus c at the end. Okay. It's kind of a rough one, but it's not like the integration by parts that you had to do twice. So at least you can say that. All right. Let's tackle this one. This one has secant squared x, tangent squared x, dx. The derivative of tangent is secant squared. Anytime that you have an even power of secants, choose your du to be secant squared, in this case, x dx. And then your u for that has to be tangent x. Okay? If you have more powers of secants, you will trade them in for tangent squares. But for this problem, now the integral becomes tangent squared, that's u squared, and then the secant squared dx becomes du. We have 1/3, 1/3 u cubed plus c, and that is 1/3 tangent cubed theta, tangent cubed x plus c. Okay. That one was kind of easy, right? But generally speaking, on these, you spot by seeing are there an even number of, or is there an even power of secant? If so, choose u to be tangent, du to be secant squared. Okay. The next one, there's odd powers of both secant and tangent. That suggests that you can let your du be secant theta, tangent theta, d theta. That's the derivative of secant theta. Okay. But if you look here, that would regroup and have you with a tan squared theta times secant theta, tangent theta, d theta. Okay. You would, in fact, have your du figured out, but the u isn't right. So you have to remember that 1 plus tan squared theta equals secant squared theta. And so that means that tan squared theta is going to be secant squared theta minus 1, right? So this integral you're wanting to do, you will think about it integrating secant squared theta minus 1, secant theta tangent theta d theta. And so that is going to be equal to u squared minus 1 du, which is a polynomial, so it's easy to do, 1/3 u cubed minus u plus c. But then you have to substitute back in and have 1/3 secant cubed theta minus secant theta plus c. Boom, done. So these are a little burly, right? This reminds me that there is an example in your textbook. Every textbook, every calculus textbook always has this example, okay? It is the integral of secant cubed. It will probably be in the integration by parts section. You need to flip over to that and read through it and see how it's done. Then put a bookmark in your textbook, because in Calc 3, that comes up as an important example that we just need to know the answer to. Just put your bookmark, remember what it is, and you don't have to repeat it. Okay? All right. So this one here, we have secant to the fourth tangent cubed. So that says that, again, it would be a good idea to have secant squared theta d theta be our du, which implies that our tan squared, no, not tan squared, our tangent theta needs to be our u. So, but that also means we've got an integral there that will have the tan cubed theta and a secant squared theta and another secant squared theta d theta, right? And so what you're going to have to do is to convert one of those secant squareds into 1 plus tangent squared theta. So now your integral turns into tangent cubed theta times 1 plus tangent squared theta secant squared theta d theta. And that then is going to be an integral of u cubed 1 plus u squared du, okay? And that's not too bad. You're just integrating u cubed plus u to the fifth. And so you've got 1/4 u to the fourth plus 1/6 u to the sixth plus c. And at the end, we substitute back in 1/4 tangent to the fourth theta plus 1/6 tangent to the sixth theta plus c. As you'll see up here in my answer, I gave two different versions, 1/6 tangent to the sixth plus 1/4 tangent to the fourth, or you could also get it in terms of secants. I'd get it in terms of tangents. I don't remember why I wrote that extra version in there. So, all right. Okay, so, whoa, wait a minute, stop. Why are you doing this? Okay. All right. These two are kind of unfair because now they're asking you to do cosecant and cotangent. But it does turn out that 1 plus cotangent squared at theta is equal to cosecant squared theta, and that the derivative of cosecant theta turns out to be negative cosecant theta cotangent theta which means that when we look at this problem here, and it's got odd powers of both cosecant and cotangent, the sensible choice is to choose my du to be cosecant x cotangent x dx. And I need to have a negative sign with that, right? So, well, sorry, I should write down first that I wanted this to be cosecant x. Since I need a negative sign with that, I'm going to put it on this side. Okay, so the cosecant cotangent is going to end up being my negative du. So this here turns into the integral cosecant squared x cotangent squared x cosecant x cotangent x dx. Okay. And that then is equal to, oh, I'm sorry, messed it up. Right. Since we want things to get cosecants, that means that we have to get rid of those cotangents. Fortunately, we can see up above how to trade them in. And so we will end up with an integral of cosecant squared x times cosecant squared x minus one. Okay. And then times cosecant x cotangent x dx. Replacing piecewise, the cosecant squared becomes u squared minus one, and then minus du. Okay. Now you can do something different with this if you want, but the way I thought of was that I would just pull the minus into those parentheses, and then I will have parentheses u squared minus u to the fourth du. Okay. You could just pull the minus to the front, six of one, half dozen the other. All right. So we have one third u cubed minus one fifth u to the fifth plus c, one third cosecant cubed x minus one fifth cosecant to the fifth x plus c. All right, when I'm looking at the answer that I've got up there, there's an extra minus. I do not see why. Okay, sorry. I don't spot anything that went awry with that, so I think that is a typo. Yes. You'd think I would have caught that last time I taught the course. But anyway, all right, one more of these here. This time we have an even power of cosecant. So that means I want to go ahead and have cosecant squared x dx in my du. But because I'm going to go ahead and choose cotangent x here, I need a negative, and I'll put it into the negative du. Okay. So then this is nice enough to set up. You're going to have a u to the fifth and a minus du. So we'll end up with minus one sixth u to the sixth plus c. And that's just minus one sixth cotangent to the sixth x plus c. Okay. And that's what I got. All right. Yay! Hopefully, I know you're probably not enjoying these, but hopefully you kind of get a challenge out of them, that it's really like a puzzle of trying to fit things in and figure out, what to put where. Let me finally say about these cosecant, cotangent, and for that matter, the secant and tangent. If everything goes right square to hell and you just can't make anything fit, Often you can just turn them into sines and cosines, and you can kind of piece something together out of that. Okay. All right. One more page. These are another trick one. So if you remember from trigonometry, sine of A plus B is sine A cosine B plus sine B cosine A. And sine of A minus B is sine A cosine B minus sine B cosine A. Okay. If you add those two equations together, the left-hand side becomes a sum, and the right-hand side cancels out two terms and then has another two terms that get doubled. So that means once you've got that, you could divide by two on both sides. And I'll do that by erasing my two and saying one half out in front of it. Okay. So what that means, oh, by the way, those are referred to as the product to sum identities. That means if I've got sine, cosine, okay, and they're different numbers there, I can trade them in, say this is one half of the integral. Now I'm going to say the sum of those two things. So quantity sine 6x plus, and then I do the difference of those two things. So sine of, they could be in either order. So I believe it's okay to go ahead and say sine of 2x instead of trying to talk about sine of negative 2x. It's a little weird. But those are pretty easy to integrate. Integral of a sine has to be a negative cosine. And because it's a linear u sub, you'll have one over that value. Likewise, minus one half cosine 2x. And for our plus c out at the end. And so let's see, I might factor out a minus one fourth of the whole thing. And then, no, let me rephrase. I'll pull a minus one twelfth out, and then I'll have a cosine 6x. And because the one half there didn't have the other one third, then we'll say plus three cosine 2x plus c. Okay. That should be pretty close. Oh, that's it. That is, in fact, exactly how I wrote it, except there's a minus. That minus. Minus, and the minus is on that other one. I think the reason the minus is there is because when I did this before, I said 2x minus 4x. But it really, oh, because the 4x is on the cosine. That's what's going on. Nope, that should have been 2x minus 4x. And so that means we have a sine of negative 2x. And so this becomes a minus. And that means that this becomes a plus. And then when we factor out the minus here on this one, we get the minus like that. Is that what that answer went? Nope, it was the other. Oh, but I've got a minus out at the front. So yeah. So this is the same thing, just okay. So the other one here is that if you look at the cosine angle subtraction and angle additions, the sine, the plus or minus here, disagrees with the one here. Okay. So if you say cosine of A minus B minus the cosine of A plus B, then you get two sine A sine B. If you wanted to have it the other way around, You could just add them and then you'd get cosine cosine, right? So with the integration that we've got here, it will turn into an integral of, oh, one half of an integral, because I forgot to do that this time. I was supposed to come over here and say one half of that stuff. Okay. So I need to have a one half out front, and then I need to do a cosine a minus b. So we've got 1x minus 3x. Okay. And then minus the cosine of a plus b. And that's going to be x plus 3x dx. So this is one half of the integral of the cosine of minus 2x. Now, here's the thing. Cosine of minus 2x and cosine of 2x are equal. That's one of our numerous identities that nobody ever memorizes. But then minus the cosine of 4x dx. Okay. So, like I said, the minus 2 there, because of the even identity for cosine, we can just drop that. Okay. And then we have one half times, and we integrate. Cosine integrates the sine, but we'll get the one half out front minus one fourth sine 4x and plus c at the end. Now I'm going to factor out a one fourth from the whole thing so that I end up with one half times one fourth is one eighth. And then because I factored out a one fourth from a one half, there's a 2 sine 2x minus sine 4x close plus c. And that is in fact what I got on the previous occasion. All right. We'll stop there. Yeah, these are yucky, I know. We get through this set of material here, this chapter and stuff. And when you do these in the future, you will let a computer do them for you. But I feel that it's important for us to be smarter than the computer. At least until the singularity happens and we get artificial super intelligences that will tell us what to do. Yeah. Okay. It's 10:40. I'm letting you go. I hope you watch this with the speed turned up because I know I was kind of dragging. All right. I will see you next Friday.